dialogues, how he describes Socrates being seized by an idea. Already Lacan noted it, how it's really a description of someone in a hysterical seizure, you know, all of a sudden immobilized, like a moment of madness. Then we know all the story of Plato, that the hypothesis of the evil spirit and so on, universalized madness. You probably know the polemics between Foucault and Derrida concerning the state of madness. Not to mention Hegel, who is, by common sense philosophers, dismissed as the ultimate madman in philosophy. It's incredible how many, it's almost now no longer. Now there is a weird rehabilitation of Hegel even within the Anglo-Saxon tradition. But I'm unfortunately old enough to know that when I was young, it was still that even the, let's call them, tolerant liberal Anglo-Saxons, they were ready to concede maybe there is something in Kant, maybe here, there, but not Hegel. Hegel is the point of complete madness. Madness in this ridiculous sense, you know, the idiot who doesn't see there is reality out there, who thinks he can read the mind of God, blah, blah, and so on and so on. Now, the third point, most interesting, maybe, at least for me, is that these three philosophers are usually conceived, understood as anti-event philosophers. Like, what can be more anti-evental than the Platonic idea that we have some eternal order of, well, notions, ideas existing in an immutable way, and that nothing really happens. All that happens is anamnesis, it's remembrance. All the movement of our soul is rediscovering what already is deep within ourselves. Nothing new happens. We just rediscover the truth that is already there. As you maybe know, of course. The idea is that this is Kierkegaard's idea, that only with Christianity something new happens. Christianity is event. Kierkegaard develops this very nicely. How? The death of Christ is precisely a temporary event which can be even empirically located, and that, do I talk too fast or no?
A little bit slow will be good, but...
Okay, I can make an honest attempt, whatever will be the result of it. So again, Plato seems to be the ultimate philosopher of anti-event. Nothing new under the sun. Nothing happens. The eternal order is here. The only movement is a movement of, the Germans say it, Zerfall, disintegration. And the point is how to get back to the original undisturbed state. The same thing, the same may appear for Descartes and even more for Hegel. Hegel nonetheless has a system, although Hegel may appear to be the philosopher of event, dialectical movement, but as Hegel himself put it, in the course of dialectical movement, things are only becoming what they always already eternally are. So we have a closed circle. Is it like this? Now I want to develop a little bit why I think it's not like this. Of course, if we look at immediately at the content of Plato's thought, of course, there seems to be no event there. But look what actually happens in Plato. And here again, I follow Alain Badiou's wonderful reading. What's the, as it were, zero level of the Platonic experience? It is that we live our ordinary daily life, immersed in our ordinary interests, fears, whatever, and then we encounter an idea. And this is the Platonic event. It's like, you know, Saul's conversion into Saint Paul and so on. Something happens, a radical cut, you discover another dimension. That's the Platonic event. No wonder that Plato was celebrating love as madness. And Plato emphasized the love as the beginning of wisdom. Usually this is only taken as moment of gradual ascension, you know, like first you love a concrete body, then you generalize it to all beautiful bodies, then you drop the body itself to the idea of beauty and so on. But nonetheless, I think that we should never forget how it all begins for Plato. Again, you are in your daily universe thinking about these, that, pleasures, blah, blah, and suddenly you encounter someone who brutally confronts you as the object of your love, and everything turns around. Your life is forever changed. You can feel in Plato this brutal encounter in all its strength, the encounter which is in a way beyond good and evil. If you are passionately in love, then, you know, even your most intimate rational interests, parents, children, colleagues, all can vanish. Your entire life is refocused. You experience a weird indifference towards your moral obligations with regard to the people around you, and so on, and so on. So this falling in love is the Platonic event. I think that precisely this is what is, at least for me, I know whenever I mention this, it gets me into big trouble. But I think that this dimension, the way I see it again, is missing in, I hate the term, I'm accused of racism when I use it, Oriental thought. What I want to say is this, that, and here I'm on the side of Plato, that what for Oriental approach is, as it were, the origin of evil, the fall. Like, no, the Oriental idea is you are in some kind of undisturbed state of bliss, and then you get too engaged, you fall into. But what Plato celebrates is precisely this falling into, as full engagement. So this would be the Plato event. Then, Descartes. Don't forget that Descartes' cogito is precisely a pure event. It's not, here Descartes immediately misunderstands himself. Cogito is not a substance which is thinking. This is already Descartes' metaphysics. No, cogito is this experience that of a thing that exists only insofar as it is thinking, only in the course of the process of thinking. And what is crucial here, I think, maybe even absolutely crucial, is not to forget that when he describes this pure experience of cogito, Descartes is not playing some intellectual games. He's describing a very concrete, let's call it, mystical spiritual experience. I don't know how deep you are in mysticism, but you know, you have this wonderful notion of the night of the world, when you withdraw in a kind of psychotic reduction. You withdraw from reality into the abyss of your soul. It's the point of darkness, but darkness is the ultimate depth of your soul. And this, again, what Descartes is describing as cogito ergo sum is precisely this thought disconnected from reality, this pure moment of inwardness, which is at the same time the moment of madness. The thesis is, and I don't have time to develop it, I did it in my big fat book, which was mentioned, that Hegel was well aware of how, in order for human spirit, our symbolic universe, to develop, we have to go through this zero point of madness. Hegel is here more Foucauldian than maybe than Michel Foucault himself, in this idea that madness is not just a possibility that thing goes wrong, but our rational world, as it were, emerges only as a defense against the threat of madness. Hegel says this openly, that even if empirically we are not, most of us, mad, but the only way to understand human reason is as a reaction to madness, maybe even as a form of madness. In what sense? There is a wonderful passage in Freud's reading of his big analysis of paranoia, the so-called Judge Schreber case, where Freud says something very important, which is usually misunderstood. Freud says that in a paranoiac system, what we usually take as the sign of madness is, on the contrary, an attempt to get out of madness. Namely, the paranoia construct is a kind of a ersatz pseudo-normality. The true madness is the night of the world, the withdrawal from reality, the disintegration of your psychic universe. And again, the paranoiac system is already an attempt, of course, a crazy attempt, but an attempt to cure yourself. Lacan sometimes, I'm not sure one should do this radical step, but nonetheless, Lacan sometimes along these lines proposed that there is a moment of madness in all rationality, in the sense that every rationality is a mad attempt to get out of madness. We got this. The three philosophers, the philosophers of event. Plato, Platonic event, you encounter the idea. And as you, I hope you got it, how, that's what I want to deliver to you, how we can formulate the basic Platonic experience independently of all this idealist, substantialist metaphysics. I'm not claiming that there are eternal ideas existing independently of us and so on and so on. I'm just saying that in authentic moments of love, political engagement, we encounter some kind of absolute. And again, I don't mean absolute in any bullshitty metaphysical sense or whatever. Just something strikes you, and as someone, also morality, there is a nice, can work as an absolute in what sense? I forgot who, in some novel, I know in which novel, because it's a shitty novel and a shitty movie which should be publicly burned, I hate it. Did you see that bullshit, The Life of Pi? Yeah, and I'm embarrassed because through James Seamus I know Ang Lee, and he now wants to meet me. No, I'm not boasting now, because I'm afraid to meet him. He wants from me some kind of a metaphysical justification how deep the movie is. Fuck him, it's bullshit, I claim. But in the novel, Life of Pi, there is a deep, correct formulation where you find the statement that when you mask